What is up, Pigeon Heads? This video is a detailed step-by-step tutorial on how to install, configure, and tune your engine for a water methanol injection kit. I will not talk about the working concept of water methanol injection. This was discussed in my previous video. This video covers the following: hardware install, wiring, nozzle position selection, nozzle sizing, and ECU tuning. I will be installing the Snow Performance Stage 2 kit, but almost everything you will see in this video applies to other kits from other manufacturers as well as DIY kits. I decided to go with the Snow Performance kit because it's a very comprehensive, high-quality kit that's also very straightforward to install and comes with some very, very nice instructions that are very helpful during the installation and tuning. Okay, let's get started. The first thing we'll install is the tank or the reservoir. You can install this anywhere, but I recommend that you install it somewhere far away from heat as well as road debris. Usually the car's trunk works well for this. To install the tank, you just need to find or provide 4 studs or bolt holes and bolt it down. I used 2 existing holes in my trunk and made another small bracket for the remaining 2 mounting points. Before you install the tank, make sure to install the outlet nozzle, which will feed water to the pump. All threads in this kit are self-sealing NPT threads, so they don't really need any sort of sealant, but I prefer to install them with a bit of sealant. The Snow Performance kit comes with the correct sealant for this application. Something else this kit has is a fluid level warning sensor that tells you when the tank is about to run dry. This is optional and you don't have to install it, but I think it's a nice, useful feature. The fluid level sensor is connected to a little warning light that you install in the interior of your vehicle. The light flashes red when the water level is low. Next, it's time to install the pump. The pump can be installed both in a horizontal or vertical position, but it must be installed close to the tank, and the inlet nozzle of the pump must be below the level of the outlet nozzle of the tank so that the water drains easily into the pump without the pump having to suck the water up. Both the tank and the pump should be installed below the level of the intake manifold of the engine where the water methanol mix will be injected. The pump also needs 4 mounting bolts, and I made them in the trunk close to the tank. It's very important to note the direction of the fluid through the pump. The arrow on the pump top shows where the water comes in from the tank and where it goes out to go to the nozzle. Before you bolt down the pump, it's a good idea to connect the tank and the pump since the nozzle connections can be difficult to access once they're in the trunk. The Snow Performance kit comes with a great length of high-quality hose appropriate for this application, and the way you install this hose is that you first pass it through the nut and then push it onto the nozzle all the way down. Once that is done, you tighten the nut to create a watertight seal. After this, you can install the controller electronics. I installed mine in the trunk using mostly existing mounting holes. The final piece of hardware that needs to be installed is the map sensor that comes in the kit. The map sensor is connected to the controller and provides boost pressure information to the controller so that it knows when to start injecting the water. The map sensor needs to be connected to a reliable source of intake manifold pressure. It's usually easiest to install a T-fitting to the hose going to the map sensor feeding information to your ECU, or alternatively you can choose to use your blow-off valve and connect a T-fitting to that and feed it to the map sensor of your water methanol kit. Once all this is connected, it's time to wire everything together. The wiring for this kit is extremely simple, and all you really need to provide is a ground wire and switched 12-volt power wire, so just 2 wires. I grounded the entire system in the same spot where I grounded my engine, and the switched 12 volts you can take from pretty much anywhere. What's important is that the wire has no power when the key is in the off position, but has power when the key is in the first or on position, and also when the engine is running. Once you find the wires, it's a matter of drilling a hole through your firewall and getting these wires to the controller and the pump. You also need a hole in the firewall so that you can pass the little display where you set the injection timing together with the low-level fluid warning light into the passenger compartment. Once everything is wired up, we can test the system and prime our pump. To do this, we simply fill the tank, connect the pump directly to the 12-volt switched wire, and run the pump outlet into a bottle or other canister. When you turn the key to the on position, water should start flowing into the canister. Once this happens, you know that your system works properly and that your pump is primed and ready for duty. So once we know that everything is working properly, we can now install our nozzle and connect it to the pump outlet. When we install our nozzle, we must carefully consider our installation location. It's usually not a good idea to install the nozzle before the intercooler. It can be done, but it creates a risk of the water mist accumulating and creating little pools inside the complex structure of the intercooler. This can then negatively impact how your engine runs because it may result in uneven power delivery or erratic air-fuel ratios or something similar. Whether this happens depends on the size and design of your intercooler, but it's hard to know how it will work before testing. So it's best avoided because installing before the intercooler has not been shown to significantly reduce intake air temperatures compared to other locations. If you're running a turbo or a centrifugal supercharger, then you cannot install the nozzle into the turbo intake because the high-speed water and methanol droplets can erode the leading edges of your compressor wheel. If you're running a screw type or a root supercharger, then you should install the nozzle before the supercharger. This is the ideal nozzle location for such applications. This means that in turbocharged, intercooled applications such as mine, the nozzle should be installed after the intercooler, but before the throttle body. I decided to install my nozzle inside the silicone hose coupling before my throttle body. Although an installation into a hard surface such as here in the intercooler outlet side is preferred, I chose the silicone hose because it meant that I didn't have to remove and drill and tap my intercooler. Also, the problem with my intercooler location is that it's very close to my boil valve, so the water mist would likely be vented outside into my engine bay. Once I drilled out my silicone hose, the only real challenge was to properly tighten the provided nozzle fitting onto the hose. To make sure there are no leaks, apply sealant around the base of the fitting and threads. The fitting is then tightened by using a large Torx bit, which I held using a wrench, and then tightened the fitting using another wrench. I have not noticed any leaks anywhere near this fitting after more than 500 kilometers of driving. Once the fitting is in the hose, we can install the actual water injection nozzle into its fitting. But before we do this, we must choose the correct nozzle size. Snow Performance provides a very nice and straightforward reference on how to do this based on your target horsepower. I started with 200 horsepower and 1 bar of boost, but my target was 300 horsepower, so I installed the size 3 nozzle. This kit also comes with a check valve that should be installed before the nozzle. The check valve makes sure that water cannot leak or drain into the engine under any circumstance other than when it's actually desired for it to go into the engine. Also, be careful that the direction of your nozzle is correct. The filter side of the nozzle goes to the check valve and not to the engine. Once everything is installed, we can proceed with the tuning. The first step with the tuning is to set your injection timing. This is set on the little display and it is absolutely detrimental to the performance of your system. There are only two things you can set: the start time of the injection and the end time of the injection. The rule of thumb is to set the injection start time at about 40% of your maximum boost pressure. So if you're running 1 bar or 14.5 psi of boost, then you will set injection start time at around 0.4 bar and end time at 1 bar. In other words, the water methanol injection will start at 0.4 bar and the controller will inject progressively more and more water methanol as the boost pressure increases, with the maximum water methanol quantity being injected at 1 bar of boost. This is called progressive injection, and I strongly recommend to install a water methanol system which has some sort of controller that allows you to set a start and an end time, because without it, it can be very difficult to tune your system properly. But this rule of thumb of 40% maximum boost pressure as your start time only works if your target horsepower and nozzle size are well matched. Let's imagine your target horsepower is 250. In that case, your recommended injection amount is 175 milliliters per minute. So the size 2 nozzle is too small, whereas the size 3 nozzle is a bit too big. But don't worry, you can easily compensate for this with the injection timing. In this scenario, the correct course of action would likely be to choose the larger nozzle and set the injection timing to start a bit later, let's say somewhere around 60 to 65% of your maximum boost pressure. In general, if you choose an overly large nozzle or too early of an injection timing, you will notice a power loss because of water injection. The overly large amount of water mist coming in too soon negatively impacts the combustion flame front and kills power. If you experience a power loss or measure it on a dyno after installing the water methanol system, then you can start by setting the injection timing later. If that doesn't help, you will likely have to go to a smaller nozzle. Alternatively, you can increase your boost pressure and ignition timing even further, because the power loss tells you that there is now ample space to safely add even more boost and timing. Speaking of boost and timing, these are the main ways to harness the potential of your water methanol injection system. It is important to understand that simply installing the water methanol injection kit and not doing anything in terms of boost pressure or ignition timing will likely result in zero power gains, or more often a power loss. Water methanol injection does not make power by itself. It simply allows you to run more boost or timing than you ever could without it. When it comes to boost pressure, you can increase it until you detect knock or reach the desired usable power output. In my case, I increased boost pressure from 1 to 2 bar and didn't detect any knock. Once you're done with boost pressure, you can play with the timing. This is my ignition map, and for example, you can see that at peak boost, I'm running relatively conservative timing. This is adequate timing without water methanol injection, but it's actually conservative with water methanol injection. Increasing timing by a few degrees here can easily gain another 10, 20, or likely even more horsepower. The final thing with respect to tuning are the air-fuel ratios. If you are running a VE or volumetric efficiency based ECU, then you can just leave your VE map alone, because the ECU will adjust your fueling during water methanol injection to reach the same target air-fuel ratios as before without water methanol injection. The wideband oxygen sensor simply reads the oxygen content in your exhaust stream and doesn't care what kind of fuel you are adding or running. So if you inject ethanol or methanol, the ECU will detect a richer mixture and simply reduce the amount of gasoline until the target air-fuel ratio is reached again. I set my target air-fuel ratios to 12.5 everywhere in boost, although in theory, the air-fuel ratio for best power when running water methanol injection or water ethanol injection should be richer than 12.5, because the best power air-fuel ratios for ethanol and methanol are lower than those for gasoline. So if ethanol or methanol is in the mix, then the target air-fuel ratio should also be lowered. We experimented with 12.3 to 1 and even 12 to 1 target air-fuel ratios, but we didn't notice any significant or consistent change in torque and power at any RPM between the three different air-fuel ratios. I was previously running 11 to 1 because my previous setup without water methanol injection experienced knock once, so I ran very rich for safety. Running water methanol injection with such an air-fuel ratio was too rich and resulted in a consistently measurable power loss of around 15 to 16 horsepower. So there you have it, water methanol or water ethanol injection, a very effective tool for engines with forced induction that allows them to increase both performance and safety. A final note that I'd like to address is the concern some commenters expressed in my previous video regarding the possibility of rust or damage occurring to the engine when water and or alcohol is injected. I'd just like to say that there is no risk of this occurring, as we are not injecting a stream of fresh water into the engine. We are injecting a fine mist that fully vaporizes by the time it reaches the combustion chamber. On top of this, engines naturally have water present in them, both in the exhaust and in the crankcase, so we're not really doing something crazy and unconventional. Water injection systems have been successfully employed as far back as World War II aircraft, and various manufacturers like Saab achieved good results with these systems. They actually theoretically improve engine life by cleaning away carbon deposits from pistons and valves and keeping internal temperatures in check. So, that's pretty much it. As always, thanks a lot for watching. I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.